Good afternoon, everybody, and thank you very much for this invitation. If you don't mind, I stay here because it's a little bit more informal and maybe we can have a better discussion. It's a great pleasure for me, obviously, to be here. I hope we will have a very interesting exchange about European matters, but hopefully also about Irish matters. I would like also to learn from you what is happening in your country, because it's really relevant to have an exchange also on different issues that are at stake at the same moment at different levels in Europe and in the country contexts. What I would like to do with you this afternoon is to try to share the trade union analysis of the economic crisis on the one side, but also on the other side, try to see if there are perspectives to change the current situation in terms of growth and social progress. First of all, okay, my name, I was already introduced to you, is Luca Visentini. I've been recently elected General Secretary of the European Trade Union Confederation in the Congress we held in Paris more or less three months ago. The ETUC, the European Trade Union Confederation, is the only existing confederation of trade unions at the European level, at the level of the European Union. We gather all the trade unions that exist in the European member states, but also in all the countries that are associated and candidated to enter the European Union. So we have 90 confederations affiliated to the ETUC and 9 European trade union sectoral federations. And in total, we represent more or less 45 million workers in our continent, in 35 countries. As I said, we held our Congress in Paris at the beginning of October. We set our priorities for the next 4 years, and it's clear that these priorities are mainly dealing with the current situation of economic crisis in which we are unfortunately still stuck as the European continent, and also what the trade unions, but more in general the social partners, should try to do in this context to try to change this situation and try to get better results in terms of social progress, but also in terms of economic growth. Significant challenges are in front of us at the moment. As I said, Europe is still in a crisis, probably the worst crisis we faced in the last 70 years after the Second World War. We face some slight signs of recovery at the moment, but unfortunately, in most of the countries, probably in all the countries, these signs of recovery are not accompanied by job creation. So we are really in a slight jobless growth in Europe and at the moment. All the statistics really confirm this situation. So there is no increase in jobs in general, even less increase in quality jobs in particular, and the levels of unemployment are still really high in all the European countries, even in countries that are experiencing a little bit better situation like Germany or others. What we say usually about this situation is that Europe became, unfortunately, the black hole of the global economy. And this condition of very low growth and deflation is also affecting the other economies around the world. It's not a coincidence that Mr. Obama several times claimed in this respect and called the European Union to change its austerity policies to try to overcome the crisis in Europe, because this should and could benefit also the others, could have also a positive impact on the other economies around the world. The problem is why Europe is in this situation. Because after several years of crisis, this crisis started 2008 in Europe, maybe a little bit earlier in the rest of the world, in the US. So it's really too many years we are stuck in this situation, but we are the only ones that are not able to sort out. And so why we are there, and our opinion as the trade unions is that there is really and clearly something not working properly in the macroeconomic strategies put in place by the European Union and the European Member States so far. The so-called obsession with austerity has not delivered in terms of concrete results, and has on the contrary dangerously weakened the EU economy and our internal social cohesion. In this country, in Ireland in particular, but also in other countries, trade unions were at the forefront, so-called forefront, in warning about the dangers of relying on a strategy built only on austerity, and the achievement of unrealistic targets with no reference to the human cost that can produce in the economy and in the society. The insistence we faced that uncontrolled public expenditure was the main cause of the crisis is really a paradox. And this paradox hides the real origin of the crisis. We perfectly know that the financial bubbles and also the member states indebting themselves to save the banks, these were the real causes of the situation in which we are. So there is a narrative going on, especially in the last years in Europe, that really inverted the causes with the consequences of the economic situation in which we are stuck. We think that the rules set in the Stability Pact are completely irrational. They have no basis in scientific terms and in the economics. And these rules, together with the Troika's memorandums, depressed the economies of the EU and made it impossible for the countries most exposed to the crisis to repair their debt. Cuts in pensions, cuts in social protection systems, together with imposed decentralization of collective bargaining structures, led to a downward spiral also for wages, for internal demand, and as an unwanted and unexpected consequence of that, even depressed productivity and competitiveness of companies and sectors. So the depression of wages correspond to a depression in productivity and competitiveness. These facts now are really evident in all the statistics provided by the different statistics institutes at the European and global level. The European Commission is starting recognizing that, and even the International Monetary Fund in its analysis recognized that destroying collective bargaining, destroying industrial relations, and having this kind of downward spiral of wages transform the European economy in a situation of deflation and recession, and there is no positive result in terms of increasing productivity and competitiveness. The data and the statistics are really evident in this respect. The problem is that all the institutions are starting recognizing the truth in this sense, but they didn't change their policy because we are still facing neoliberal policies and austerity as the main and only solution to face this situation. We want always to clarify as the trade unions that we are not against sound public budgets nor against sustainable welfare systems. We are against cuts, not accompanied by investment and counter-cyclical measures. This is the point. We think that Europe really needs alternative economic governance. It needs it now, and it has to be based on investment and internal demand. Investment and internal demand are the two pillars that we put at the core of our strategy that we discuss and set in our Congress and on which we are committed to develop our actions in the near future. Public investment, first of all, this is the first pillar, because only public investment is able to generate confidence in private investors too. And also because public investment is the only tool that is really certain to go into the real economy instead of into financial speculation. To a sound European industrial policy, to research and innovation, to education and training, to the human factor in the economy. So it's impossible to convince private investors only to invest on these assets. And without these elements in the economy, it's impossible to recover the crisis. This is crystal clear. That's why we are significantly trying to negotiate with the European Commission the so-called Juncker's plan for investment. This plan, as you know, has been launched 1.5 years ago, more or less, immediately after the Commission started its mandate, the new Commission started its mandate. You know probably some details about this plan. This plan should be based on 315 billion euros to be invested in 3 years, but the real available public money at the basis of the plan is only 21 billion euros, 5 coming from the Commission, 16 coming from the European Investment Bank, and then there should be a so-called financial leverage going to the financial markets to convince the investors, the private investors, to transform 15 times, to multiplicate 15 times this amount of public money into a general amount of mainly private money up to 315 billion euros. There are different problems in this kind of scenario. The first problem is that we still think that the scenario is quite unrealistic. It's true that in some, let's say, projects for investment coming from the European Investment Bank, it was possible in the past to have this kind of multiplicator, 15 times, 16 times, but it happened only when there were very clear projects, very well-focused projects in specific sectors and for specific companies. But having a general plan for investment to recover the European economy in general based on the same mechanism is really unlikely to produce concrete results. It's not a coincidence that if you consider the composition of the projects that the European Commission put at the core of this plan, you will find that there are 75 billion euros mainly earmarked for small and medium enterprises, and this money is there. And it's already producing results because these enterprises are ready to do something in this respect. But the rest of the plan that should be that should go, let's say, to the other strategic investment plans that are linked to the industrial sectors, physical and immaterial infrastructures, education and training, social investment, etc., etc. Well, for that, the private money is simply not available because it's impossible to convince the private investors to participate in this kind of general of public interest plans without putting at the core of the plan a significant part of public money. So this is the first problem, that the money for the most relevant projects is not there. The second problem is that traditionally, when most of the money comes from private investors and passes through the European Investment Bank, well, most of the projects are targeted on strong and big countries, strong and well-developed sectors, and big and multinational companies. It's very difficult to convince the investors to go to Greece or to Poland or to Portugal to invest their money, and it's very difficult to convince them to invest this money in old-fashioned industrial sectors or sectors that are experiencing troubles in the financial and international markets, on small and medium enterprises, and obviously it's very difficult to convince them to invest this money in education and training, in social investment, and in projects that can really produce job creation in a really appreciable way and concrete way. So it's quite clear that not only in terms of origin of the money and capacity to generate the quantity of the money that is at the basis of the plan, but also in terms of the possibility to send the money to the right places, to the right projects, and to use the money in the right way, there are incredible question marks at the basis of this plan. But the most relevant element is that without public investment, it's impossible to generate private investment. There is a very interesting book that was written a couple of years ago by an important Italian-American economist, Mariana Mazzucato is her name. She's now teaching in London. In this book, The Entrepreneurial State, she demonstrates very clearly that the most innovative sector and let's say, cluster existing in the world, that is the Silicon Valley in the US, was created thanks to public money, not thanks to private money, not thanks to funds created in the financial markets. Even companies like Apple, Microsoft, Facebook, Google, etc., they were, in their startup origin, they were financed by public money, because in the US, rightly, the government set up an important federal agency to support innovation in the economy. The problem is that this is not recognized at all in the general global and European narrative when we speak about macroeconomic investment. Always we see simply an incredible emphasis on the need to mobilize private investment and the fact that only private investment can really create productivity and competitiveness for companies in the economy. But the reality is exactly the opposite. So public investment and investment that can really go to the right sectors and to the right priorities of the economy should be the core of an European strategy to overcome the crisis. But unfortunately, the so-called Juncker's plan, as I said, even if it's positive, is a first signal of a change in the macroeconomic course coming from the European policies of the European Commission, because in the past, speaking about investment with the Barroso cabinet was almost a scandal. It was impossible, a taboo. You could even not touch in any kind of European level discussions. At least now there is something going on in terms of different topics for discussion, and even the European institutions start recognizing that there is a need for investment, but the tools and the programs that have been put in place, unfortunately, are still absolutely insufficient. That's why we, as the European Trade Union Confederation, a couple of years ago, we launched an alternative initiative for investment. We call it A New Path for Europe. We called for 2% investment of the European GDP. It means 250 billion euros per year for 10 years. So you can understand a completely different quantity and quality of investment. We based our own plan, trade union plan, on well-funded macroeconomic analysis and on revenues that are realistic, but under the condition that we start thinking about an European debt, or at least an EMU debt. That means that this debt should be shared by all member states through an EU or EMU treasury and a finally real central bank issuing Eurobonds. This is the core of our proposal. Sure, we are not so naive to think that this is politically feasible in the short term, but at the same time we are still convinced that this is the only concrete solution to Europe's problem, a solution very close to the American one, by the way, because if you look at the American example, you can see that the Americans invested in the economy in the last 7 years $7,000 billion dollars public money. So this quantitative easing, increasing public spending in the US, was really a significant intervention in the economy, and it was the only way the Americans had to overcome the crisis. So we need to do exactly the same also in Europe. We think that even if for the moment probably this proposal is not so easy to be achieved in political terms, at the same time we think also that insisting on this proposal could provide a strong incentive to the EU institutions to lead the discussion into the right direction. So we aim at influencing, let's say, the European narrative on this issue and try to change the current climate and mood that we have in front of us. That's why we didn't give up on negotiating with the Commission and Vice President Katainen in particular on the quantity and the quality of investment in their own plan, the Juncker's plan, being aware that it is for the moment very poorly implemented, as I said, but we have to continue insisting on this element of investment, as I say, the first pillar of our strategy to overcome the crisis. More investment, because because, as I say, this is really essential. But at the same time, we have to acknowledge that investment alone is not enough for our economy. We also need to boost the second pillar I mentioned, that is internal demand. Why internal demand? Because most EU products remain in Europe. The statistics say more or less 65-70% of what we produce in Europe remains in Europe and goes to European consumers. So the only way we have to tackle deflation is to increase the purchasing power of EU citizens and workers. We are stuck in a deflation situation, but the only way we have to change this situation is to boost internal demand. And internal demand means that to boost internal demand, we need, first of all, to increase wages, because most of the consumers are workers, and to increase their capacity, their purchasing power, we need absolutely to increase their wages. That's why we set one important slogan at the core of our strategy, that is that European workers deserve a pay rise, which should serve competitiveness and productivity. As I said at the beginning, wage depression and wage competition push productivity down, not up, and reinforce internal European macroeconomic imbalances. Also in this case, all the statistics really show that if you have high wages bargained by social partners, you can also boost productivity and competitiveness. If there is no this link in place and you have a downward pressure on salaries, is quite sure that you have a deflation consequence on the one side, and on the other side, productivity and competitiveness of the companies goes down, exactly because 70% of our products remain in our continent. This kind of macroeconomic imbalances we have in our continent are linked to different levels of debt, obviously, and public spending, but more and more important is that they are linked to internal competition between national markets, sectors, services, wage setting and collective bargaining systems, social protection and taxation systems. Germany is the worst, for some the best, unfortunately, the worst example of internal and external competition. If you look at what Germany did in the last 12 years, this is really evident. What they did was to, on the one side, to boost export, and so to support the companies in Germany that were exporting. We have always to remember that around 2000, the year 2000, Germany was really in an incredible crisis that was due to the effects of the reunification, obviously, and all the elements linked to the reunification. And their industry was really affected by this crisis. So they decided to boost export. Fine, very positive. But to do that, they also decided to use some levers, some leverage elements in their labor market and economy that led to an incredible internal and external competition that created incredible macroeconomic imbalances. Internal, because they decided to boost competitiveness and productivity only in the companies that were really in the export side of their economy. And on the other side, they decided to depress wages and social protections and workers' protection in all the other services and industry sectors that were simply, their mandate, their mission was only to serve the export companies and the export sectors. If you look at the situation at the moment in Germany, you see that on the side of wages and working conditions, if you go to Volkswagen, for example, or to a plant of Volkswagen in one of the German cities, you can see that the salary of workers that are directly employed by Volkswagen is about 35-40 euros gross amount per hour. Then you have the workers that are employed in the subcontracting chain of Volkswagen in the industry sector. Also in the industry sector, they have salaries that are about 15-20 euros gross amount per hour, and then you go in the same plant to the workers that are employed by cleaning sector, in the cleaning sector or in the catering sector within the Volkswagen plant. These workers earn more or less 4.5 euros gross amount per hour. So in the same factory, you have different categories of workers that earn from 40 euros to 4 euros. This is the fragmentation that was introduced in Germany, not only in the systems of salary, but also more in general, in the system of collective bargaining and workers' protection. And this was made by completely destroying the national sectoral coverage of collective bargaining systems. You have now 54% of the German big companies that are outside the employers' organizations and don't apply at all the national sectoral collective agreements. On the other side, you have the other companies that apply the collective agreements, where people earn from 5 to 15 euros per hour. In addition to that, and so we don't have no more erga omnes coverage for collective agreements in Germany. Collective agreements, collective bargaining institutions and industrial relations have been completely fragmented because they should serve export in the economy. On the other side, you have also these reforms that happen in the labor market in Germany. The so-called arts reform, four reforms have been approved by the German parliament during the Schröder government. These reforms have introduced the so-called mini-jobs. The mini-jobs are now in Germany more or less 7.5 million people. These people earn more or less 450 euros net amount per month, and they work up to 40 hours per week. So they are mainly full-time, they don't have any concrete pension and social protection, and they receive 450 euros per month. It's clear that thanks to this kind of reforms, the level of unemployment in Germany has been completely depressed. It went down and down, and now we are in Germany more or less around 4.5% of unemployment. But if you consider the number of working hours Germany had in 2000-2002 and the number of working hours they have in the economy, in the labor market at the moment, they didn't increase the number of working hours by one single working hour. So they multiplicated the number of jobs. They have 7.5 million workers more, but they simply redistributed among more people the same number of working hours. It means that not a real, concrete, net single new job has been created in Germany in the last 15 years. These people, the mini jobs, now they have the minimum wage, fortunately, and the German trade union has been obliged to claim for a minimum wage by law because they were no more able to bargain the collective agreements. But the mini jobs and all these people, precarious people in the labor market, since there is a rule in the German constitution that says that you cannot earn less than the poverty threshold, that is 1,000 euros, all these people are assisted by the public assistance, by the state, that integrate their salary to reach the poverty threshold. And that's why the public debt in absolute terms in Germany during the last 15 years increased a lot. It's clear that the ratio, the relationship between their debt and their GDP is still very low because the GDP is high. But if you look at the absolute figures, they have more or less now 2,700 billion euros in debt, of debt. And if you compare to the Italian debt, their debt is higher. It's clear that they have 85% of the GDP as a debt. Italy has more than 130%, but this is due to the level of GDP. But if you compare the quantity of money that every single citizen sitting in Germany has to burden in terms of indebtedness of the country, well, the level is incredibly, incredibly high. Why I describe this situation? Because I think, and we think, that this situation is really emblematic of what was the model that was spread around Europe as a solution for the crisis. But it's crystal clear that if there is a country that introduces incredible internal competition and macroeconomic imbalances to compete against the other countries in Europe, instead of having an European economy competing jointly, unitedly, all together against the rest of the world, it's clear that if we simply export the internal German competition to the rest of the European countries, instead of competing as a system, as an economic system, as an European economic system towards the rest of the world, well, the only result we can have is to increase also the macroeconomic imbalances within our continent, instead of exporting our welfare and our well-being to the rest of the world, and increasing our working conditions and, more in general, living conditions in our continent. This is a completely perverse model of economic development. It's clear that if you base everything only on export against import, surplus against deficit, and you don't compensate these macroeconomic imbalances within the European continent, there is no way in the long term to sort out from the situation of crisis in which we are. The so-called modern beggar thy neighbor is exactly what Germany applied internally first, and then what they applied externally towards the other country. In addition to that, they also, together with others, not alone, they also speculated as a second stage strategy on the public debt of the countries that were in a very difficult situation under the Troika memorandums, because 40% of the Greek debt is still in the hands of the German banks. So it's crystal clear also why Germany didn't want to implement so far the banking union, because it would introduce some controls also on the regional German banks that are the ones that have the most relevant part of the Greek debt internally in their budgets. So that's to say that for us the European economy should compete on quality and innovation instead of introducing internal competition on labor and social costs. And we think also that Europe should compete against the rest of the world, as I said, as a united economy, instead of playing a stupid bureaucratic game internally by boosting macroeconomic imbalances and then introducing rules to tackle the macroeconomic balances that Europe itself has created. So this is really a paradox, a completely irrational way to rule the economy. At the same time, we are also really shocked at the moment by the attitude of the European institutions, also in the negotiations about international trade agreements, like the TTIP, for example, that this kind of attitude goes really against the European interest. If you want, then we can also go through a little bit. This element is another chapter, let's say. But anyway, it's really interlinked with this wrong macroeconomic strategy, the attitude that we face at the moment in the way Europe is dealing with the international trade negotiations. And also, we cannot believe that the European Commission is ready at the moment to award China with the market economic status, which will create hundreds of thousands more unemployed people in our labor market. There is no sense in awarding China with this status, since China doesn't fit to all the rules that we have in the free economy of the international markets. Why Europe is doing that? We think, unfortunately, mainly for ideology, which promotes at the same time the interest of some against the others. That's why we are insisting that Europe should change the course of its economic governance by doing something like unifying its debt and strengthening its economic institutions, by revising and making flexible its internal rules, in particular the Stability Pact, which should be a means to achieve growth and well-being instead of being a rigid and abstract objective in themselves, by boosting investment and strengthening internal demand through negotiated wage increases and higher minimum wages, but also by preserving the European social model, which is our added value, not an obstacle to our competitiveness. Evidence show that productivity and competitiveness grow in countries with strong industrial relations, effective social dialogue, and efficient social models. And on the contrary, countries where social partners are not able to negotiate wages and working conditions, where bipartite and tripartite dialogue do not work, where social cohesion is replaced by increasing inequality, in these countries produce very bad economic performances. This is crystal clear everywhere, and even the statistics coming from the International Monetary Fund clearly show that where you have strong industrial relations at the national level, where you have strong protection systems, where productivity and competitiveness are performing better. Eurostat, the IMF, not radical trade union institutes are saying that. And so we have to take this analysis into account. Even the European Commission starts recognizing it. The President Juncker came to our ETUC Congress in Paris to reaffirm these elements. It's very interesting to go briefly through what Juncker said in Paris 3 months ago. He said that we need to stop austerity and start investing in the economy, that the national level industrial relations and minimum wage systems should be reestablished and reinforced, and a stop should be put to decentralization processes which have been demonstrated not to be efficient, that we need to address the lack of internal demand via a general pay rise, that we must fight against precariousness, and that the standard working contract should be the permanent one, that we need to reduce inequality and social competition by ensuring equal treatment for all, especially for mobile workers and migrants, that we need to reinforce the European social model through a social pillar for the EU-MEU economic governance, and finally, that social dialogue and the role of social partners should be fully recognized. I'm reading from the minutes that we register from Juncker's speech in front of the ETUC Congress 3 months ago. It seems the ETUC manifesto. Okay, well, we couldn't agree more, but the big question mark now is if the European Commission is coherent in really pursuing these objectives or not. This is the point. Our reply to this question mark is that the Juncker's cabinet is trying to do it, although with great contradiction between different commissioners according to their political and national backgrounds, and that the European Parliament is also trying to help in this direction. But such attempts are often weakened or blocked by a majority of governments that continue to go in the wrong direction at home or are obliged to do so by the Troika, as is still the case, unfortunately, for Greece. But also, not only Greece, what is happening in the UK, the trade union bill and the negotiations concerning the Brexit process. In Finland, all the negotiations between social partners and the state have been broken during this summertime, and now the situation is still completely stuck in this respect. It's something really unusual for a Nordic country. They were used to have very well-funded industrial relations and social dialogue, but everything is going to be destroyed by the current Finnish government, and something similar is going to happen also in Norway and in Denmark. The same is happening in Spain with people in jail because they were on strike, so something incredible in Europe until few years ago, without mentioning Hungary, what is happening in Poland, and even in progressive, so-called progressive countries like Italy or France, all this is really very, very worrying. So we have, instead of changing the course, we have at the moment in some European countries renewed austerity measures, attacks on social partners, prerogatives and trade union rights, on welfare systems and social rights. All this shows that the neoliberal ideology is not dead and that very often business continues as usual. This negative picture is obviously worsened by what is happening regarding refugees and migrants, the right to free movement, the rise of xenophobia, racism, and populism, etc., etc. This element is very complex. I won't go through that at the moment in this introduction. If you want, if you have time, later on we can also open a debate on this specific issue about the refugee emergency and the migration issues in general in Europe. Now, to conclude, the last element I would like to draw your attention on is the link between this economic situation, so the economic crisis, the austerity measures, the wrong strategies put in place by Europe and the need for a change on the one side, and on the other side, something like a crisis of democracy that the European Union is currently facing. The economic crisis, among the different consequences it produced in the last years, has also led to a, let's say, renationalization of the European decision-making processes. Austerity, budgetary rules and cuts as a trade-off for bailouts have been imposed by surplus countries on deficit countries through intergovernmental agreements instead of European pieces of law. And this is something that is often neglected by the debate, but it's really important. So we completely pass from a legislative process that was in the end of the European elected institutions to something that is decided only by the governments in the Council, and that is not only, and is not at all a piece of European legislation or an improve in the European legal framework. It's only about intergovernmental agreements that are then imposed to the Commission to be executed and to the countries to be implemented. And this is the situation in which we are at the moment. The result of that is that the institutions democratically elected by citizens to rule the Union, it means the European Parliament on the one side and indirectly the European Commission, have been completely deprived of their authority and have now very little power to convince member states to stay together and act in the common interest of Europe. This process also deprives citizens of any real possibility to control and influence European decisions, which are more and more felt as impositions. And so Euroscepticism and lack of confidence in traditional parties is on the rise in all the countries, very often accompanied by populism and xenophobia. In fact, nationalism is a very dangerous beast that the European project had contributed to send to sleep and that now has awakened again. In this context of lack of democracy, all civil society organizations, which in the past play a very important role in mediation and representation for citizens, workers, companies towards institutions, have been seen as obstacles in the process, trade unions and even sometimes employers' organizations. Social partners in general, trade unions in particular, have become for the neoliberal ideology the worst enemies of austerity and competitiveness, and so attacked and strongly affected. The European social model and social cohesion have been the victims of the parallel crisis in the economy and in democracy. This is the main battle we currently face as trade unions. And we need, but not only as trade unions, it's a matter, let's say, affecting social partners in general, or the civil societies society organizations in general. And so it's a common challenge for all of us. And we need to win this battle if we want not just to overcome the crisis, but also to restore democratic legitimacy in Europe. This is our objective, but also our responsibility as the trade unions and as the civil society organizations. We think to have some right proposals in this respect, but we need also to build up proper alliances. Why I say proper alliances? Because at the moment, it's very difficult to have, productive chats and discussions with the progressive forces existing at the European level. We try, obviously, as the trade unions, also with the other social partners, to develop discussions with the progressive forces in the European Parliament. But, well, when it comes, for example, to the discussion about the Brexit, we see 6, 7, 8 prime minister or ministers coming from progressive governments around Europe signing letters together with the conservatives about deregulating all the pieces of legislation at the European level, dismantling any social protection system, and making concessions to Mr. Cameron in the framework of the Brexit negotiations that are against the interest of workers and citizens. So, probably even the European progressive forces have, at some extent, lost their soul in the current situation. There is something that is not only linked to the need of renewing the social partners, the European trade union movement, the trade unions, and imagining new strategies and new proposals for the future. There is also an issue about how to renew and relaunch the role of the progressive forces and the progressive political organizations in the European context. So we need good discussion, proper proposals, and right alliances. As I said before, we are really convinced that there cannot be strong European economy without strong social dialogue, strong industrial relations, strong welfare systems, the European social model. There is no growth in Europe without renewing and relaunching the European social model. This implies strong social partners involvement, because we are the main actors in the economy, but we cannot do it alone. We really need to build up together new strategies for Europe. That's why we as the ETUC insist also that we want to participate in all the institutional processes going on at the European level with our proposals. But it's also really important the link that we are able to create between these European discussions going on and what is happening in the different countries, and the role that social partners and also progressive forces can play in the countries at the national level where things are happening. It's really fundamental if we want to tackle the situation in which we are at the moment in Europe. There are completely different situations, obviously, according to the different national contexts, but this element of stronger and better coordination of the European strategies is also a key element for our strategy for the future. That's why we are also struggling to relaunch the European and national social dialogue, as well as to reinforce and restore sound industrial relations in each and every country. In this sense, we have absolutely to recognize and underline that the Irish example has become really a positive benchmark for all the countries in Europe, since here trade unions and social partners have managed to restore industrial relations, minimum wage systems, and what was completely destroyed by the Troika interventions in the past. And we really appreciated what the Irish trade unions and social partners were able to do in the last couple of years. And we also discuss a lot about this positive experience, because this could be really an example for other countries where trade unions and social partners are really facing incredible challenges. To conclude, I would like only to quote the slogan I used to close the ETUC Congress in Paris. This slogan was negotiation, negotiation, negotiation. Why? Because negotiations are our core business as a trade unions, first of all, but we repeated three times negotiation because we want to negotiate at different levels, at institutional level, at collective bargaining level, and also on social issues and social and welfare systems. After Paris, we are committed to strengthen our negotiating power, to support and reinforce trade unions in all the countries, as I said, to be beside all categories of workers, starting from young, precarious, and atypical workers, women, and migrants, and starting from reflecting on the future of work as well, not only on the future of economy. And we are finally convinced that through their own renewal and by relaunching their role and prerogatives, the trade unions can really contribute to tackle the crisis in the economy and our democracy that we all are facing at the moment in this European continent. Thank you.